people shalt thou divide for an inheritance the land which I swear unto their fathers to give them. Only be thou strong and very courageous, that thou mayest observe to do according to all the law which Moses my servant commanded thee. Turn not from it to the right hand or to the left, that thou mayest prosper whithersoever thou goest. This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein. For then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success. Have not I commanded thee? Be strong and of a good courage. Be not afraid, neither be thou dismayed, for the Lord thy God is with thee whithersoever thou goest. Now, we're not going to carry out a verse-by-verse exposition of this passage this evening, but what we have read really sets the scene for what I want to bring to your attention. I want you to put yourself in Joshua's sandals tonight. Moses, his spiritual father, his mentor, his hero, his leader, his guide, has just departed from the scene. And it's time really for Joshua now to step out of the shadows and to step into the spotlight. And in the passage that we've read, one chapter closes and another chapter commences in the life of Joshua. And as he begins this new chapter, he faces a new challenge. And what an overwhelming challenge it was that he faced. To take over from Moses, the greatest leader that the people had known, the only leader that many of the people had known, and to lead the people into the promised land. What a challenge. And what's really on my mind tonight is that at times every one of us face new chapters and face new challenges in our lives. For a whole host of reasons, our circumstances may change. And a new chapter commences as a result. You know, it could be a young person leaving school and they go into the college or the university or into the workplace for the first time, and it's a new chapter that is commencing. It could be someone who finishes university and they go into the workplace, and maybe somebody who changes their course at university and it's a new chapter that's beginning. Maybe somebody who moves to a new job or to a new company. Maybe they move to a new town. Maybe they move to a new country. A new house, a new neighborhood, and a new chapter is commencing. Maybe it's someone who enters into a relationship, or someone who moves to another stage in a relationship. Maybe someone gets married, someone has their first child. And new chapters are commencing all the time. Could be in an assembly context, and maybe someone moves to a different assembly. Maybe someone is getting involved in a new work for God for the first time, and a new chapter is commencing. Could be at the other end of the spectrum, I suppose, and maybe it's the loss of a loved one. And maybe you lose someone very close to you, a mother, a father, a son, a daughter, a brother, a sister, a husband, a wife, a close friend, and circumstances change dramatically, and a new chapter commences in your life. And as we go through life, new chapters are commencing all the time. And new challenges present themselves to us all the time. And the question, I suppose, is how do we handle new chapters and new challenges in our lives? Well, tonight we want to look at four things that stood Joshua in good stead as he began this new chapter in his life. We're going to notice he had the experience of the past. And he could look back to many situations and circumstances that he had been in, and many lessons that he had learned in them. And the experience of the past would stand him in good stead for the challenges of the future. Secondly, he had the example of Moses. And he had spent many years observing this great man of God very, very closely, learning from him, and gaining advice and guidance from him, and watching how he responded and reacted to certain situations and scenarios. And so he had the example of Moses. Thirdly, he had the enlightenment of the Word. He had the Word of God, albeit a very small part of it. But we read in the passage there about the book of the law. And that was to be his guide. That was to shed light on the pathway ahead. And so he had the enlightenment of the word. And then fourthly and finally, he had the encouragement of the Lord. And in the passage that we've read, it's full of promises that the Lord gives to him as he embarks upon this new chapter and as he faces this tremendous new challenge in his life. And so these four things would stand him in good stead. And I want to suggest to us tonight that these are four things that perhaps we can relate to and will stand us in good stead as we embark upon new chapters in our lives as well. So let's think first of all about the experience of the past. You know, Joshua was commencing this new chapter in his life with a wealth of experience behind him. For many years, through the various circumstances of his life, he had been learning important lessons in the school of God. And the experiences of the past would stand Joshua in good stead to face the challenges of the future. And I think there's a general principle there, isn't there? You know, every one of us have been through things in the past. And every one of us have been through various circumstances and situations. And the things that we have learned during these times will undoubtedly stand us in good stead for some of the things that we will face in the future. You see, Joshua had built up quite a varied CV over the years. Maybe you think you've got a varied CV. Well, I suggest to you that Joshua's CV would outshine all of ours. You know, he had been a slave, he had been a soldier, he had been a servant, and he had been a spy. I'm not sure any of us could tick all those boxes on our CVs tonight, but a very varied CV he had. And through this curriculum, he had learnt much in the school of God that would equip him for this new challenge and this new chapter in his life. And we're not going to go into it all in great detail and all the things that he learned in these different stages of his life, but I want to just think about each one of these things and just pull out one main lesson that he learned from that that would stand him in good stead for the challenge he was now facing. Firstly, he had been a slave. And as a slave, he would have learned the importance of submission in service. The importance of submission in service. You know, he had spent the early years of his life in Egypt. And there as a slave, he would have learned the necessity of unwavering obedience to his master. And so when the command came in verse number 2, "Now therefore arise and go," Joshua knew the importance of submission to the master's voice, because it had been deeply impressed upon him during his time as a slave in Egypt. And so, as a slave, he learnt about the importance of submission in service. Secondly, he had also been a soldier. And as a soldier, he had learnt the secret of strength in service. The secret of strength in service. You remember, in Exodus 17, Moses assigns Joshua the responsibility of leading the army into battle against Amalek. And, you know, you could spiritualize that, and you could say that he was learning the lesson of how to deal with the flesh and so on. But on a very simple level, through that experience, he learned that battles were not fought and won in his own strength. Because you remember on that occasion, Moses and Aaron and Hur, they went up to the top of the hill. And Moses lifted up his hands to heaven and interceded with God on behalf of Joshua down in the valley fighting in the battle. And through that experience, Joshua had learned about the need for total reliance upon the Lord. And this would stand him in good stead, no doubt, as he embarked on a new chapter of service that would take him into many conflicts with numerous enemies that had to be overcome as they entered into the land. And so, as a soldier, he learned the secret of strength in service, total reliance upon the Lord. And then thirdly, for many years, he had also been a servant. And as a servant, he had learned the necessity of selflessness in service. You know, in verse number 1 of our chapter, he's introduced as Moses' minister. Moses' assistant, I suppose. And from the days of his youth, he had been Moses' right-hand man. He had been Moses' personal assistant. You see, before he could stand in the spotlight, he had to serve in the shadows. And from his youth, it seems he had learnt the importance of living his life selflessly for the benefit of others. And these years, these many years that he had spent selflessly serving Moses, prepared him for the coming years he'd spend selflessly serving the multitudes that he was given responsibility for. And so as a servant, he learnt the necessity of selflessness in service. Fourthly, he had been a spy. And as a spy, he had learnt the importance of steadfastness in service. You know, in Numbers 13, Joshua was selected as one of the 12 spies who were sent to search out the land of Canaan. And we all know the story, and we've known it since Sunday school days. 12 men went to spy in Canaan, and 10 were bad and 2 were good. It's quite difficult to say that without doing the actions, isn't it? But, you know, that was the basic point of the story, wasn't it? That 10 of them came back focused on the problems, and only Caleb and Joshua returned with enthusiasm about the possibilities. You see, as a spy, Joshua learnt many things. He learnt to see things from God's perspective, didn't he? He learnt to view things through the eye of faith, to focus on the opportunities rather than the obstacles that the others focused on. And as he returned with his report, he learnt another lesson. He learnt the importance of being true and faithful, even when others around him weren't. Furthermore, he learnt that faithfulness to God wouldn't necessarily result in popularity with man, because you remember the people chose to accept the negative reports from the 10 rather than the positive reports of the 2. And these things would all stand him in good stead as he considered the potential difficulties of the new challenge that faced him. And it's worth noting, just in passing, that these things that Joshua learned over these many years are things that we'll need to learn too as we seek to serve the Lord. You know, we'll need to learn the importance of submission in service, that we have to carry out God's work in God's way, under God's direction. And we need to also learn the secret of strength in service, that we'll never accomplish anything for God in our own strength, and that we must be completely reliant upon Him in all things. And we'll need to come also to understand the necessity of selflessness in service, that a life lived for the glory of God in the service of God is a life which is basically lived not for ourselves, but for the benefit and for the blessing of others. And finally, we'll need to be marked by steadfastness in service, to remain faithful and to remain true and to press forward and to keep going despite the difficulties and discouragements which we'll undoubtedly face along the way, just as Joshua did. But coming back to the main thrust of our thoughts tonight, it's clear that the things Joshua had learnt through the varied experiences of the past equipped him and enabled him for the challenges he would face in the future. And we can think back to many things that we have gone through in our lives, and sometimes we don't understand why at the time. But then we face something in the future, and we come to realise why we've gone through that thing in the past, because it was to stand us in good stead for the thing that we are now facing. And you know, whatever new challenges we face in the days ahead, we will no doubt be able to look back to past experiences where we learnt things. Not so much where we learnt things about ourselves, but where we learnt things about God, and where we learnt things about living for God that will stand us in good stead for whatever it is that we're now facing. And so first of all, he had the experience of the past behind him. Secondly, though, he had the example of Moses. And what a wonderful example Moses had been to Joshua over those many years. You know, undoubtedly, what he had learnt from Moses over those years would stand him in good stead as he faced what lay ahead. And, you know, as he embarked upon this new chapter in his life, and as he encountered different challenges and difficulties and decisions that had to be made, no doubt he would think back, what did Moses do in that situation? And how did Moses respond to that scenario? And what guidance did Moses give me over the years that might be applicable and appropriate here? And what a wonderful example Moses had been to Joshua. You know, just as a little side point again, our example to others is deeply important, isn't it? Because through our example, every one of us will either be a spiritual help or hindrance to others. You know, the Apostle Paul, he could present himself as an example worth emulating. And in 1 Corinthians 11, he says, "Be ye followers of me, even as I also am of Christ." You see, Paul could set himself up as an example worth following because he was a walking, talking exhibition of practical Christ-likeness, wasn't he? And you would have done well to have followed his example. And I suppose Moses' example as a man of God and as a servant of the Lord was a tremendous spiritual help to Joshua. And I suppose the question is, what about our examples? You know, let us ask ourselves the question tonight, by the example of my life, by the way that I live, by the things that I do, am I a spiritual help or hindrance to others? You know, I suppose we can all think of men and women of God whose examples we've looked up to and whose examples we've learnt from over the years. No doubt some folks maybe spring into your mind just as we say that. Folks who have been a great help to you. And maybe at times as you face new challenges in life, you think about them. And you think about the lessons you learnt from them. And you think about how they responded and how they reacted and what they would do in this situation. And it's a great help to us. You know, we don't have time to consider everything that Joshua learnt from Moses. You know, that would almost require a full character study of Moses, and we certainly don't have time to go into all that tonight. But let me just draw your attention to a few general things, a few basic things that Joshua learnt from Moses that would stand him in good stead for this new chapter in his life. He learnt, first of all, the importance of communion with the person of God. The importance of communion with the person of God. You know, Moses is described as the man of God in Deuteronomy 33 and in Joshua 14. And someone only gets the title a man of God when they are in close communion with God himself. Someone who's really in touch with God. You know, following his death in Deuteronomy 34, the scripture states that there arose not a prophet since in Israel equal to Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face. Whom the Lord knew face to face. In Exodus 33, Joshua was nearby when the Lord spake unto Moses face to face, as a man speaketh unto his friend. You see, Moses was a man who was exceptionally close to God. And through his example, Joshua learnt the necessity of personal communion with the Lord, the importance of being close to God. You know, in Acts 4, verse 13, this is a verse that always impresses me, that the religious leaders noticed there was something different about Peter and John that made them stand out. And it wasn't their education, and it wasn't their eloquence, and it wasn't their excellence. It was the fact that these men had been with Jesus. That's what they said. These men have been with Jesus. There was just something about them, wasn't there? It was the time they had spent in the presence of the Lord that gave them power in their service. And Joshua had come to learn from Moses that Moses' power came from being in the presence of God. And what a valuable lesson that would be to Joshua. And what a valuable lesson that is for us, that power in our service comes from being in the presence of God. And so he learned the importance of communion with the person of God. He learned, secondly, about the importance of commitment to the work of God. The importance of commitment to the work of God. You know, Moses was not only known as the man of God, he was also known as the servant of the Lord. And he's referred to in that way on several occasions, the servant of the Lord. And that specific term, I was interested to notice, is used only in connection with three individuals in the Bible. There's maybe deviations of it and slightly different versions of it that are used to refer to other individuals, but that specific term, the servant of the Lord, is used only in connection with three individuals: Moses, Joshua, and David. And what a wonderful example Moses was as a servant of the Lord. What an example of commitment Moses was. You know, his commitment was seen in the fact that he made tremendous sacrifices for the service of God. And his commitment was seen in that he was marked by tremendous stamina in the service of God. You know, as you think about the sacrifices he made, the summary of his life in Hebrews 11 tells us of all the things that he willingly gave up for God, all the things that he willingly and voluntarily turned his back on in order to serve God. The politics and the possessions and the pleasures and the power and the palace of Egypt. And Moses turned his back on it all, didn't he? In order that he might serve the Lord. You remember what it says, he refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season, esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures in Egypt. And Moses was a man who made tremendous sacrifices for the service of God. But you know, he was also a man who was marked by tremendous stamina in the service of God. His service for God continued over many, many years. Deuteronomy 34, verse 7 says that even on his dying day, his eyes were not weak, nor his strength gone. And there he was, still full of vision and vigor, still full of energy and enthusiasm in the things of God on the very day that he was taken home to heaven. And by the way, he was 120 years old, wasn't he? And he was still going strong for God. And you know, sometimes we think, you know, maybe we get to 60 and we can start winding down a little bit. And we can start putting our feet up and we can take some retirement from the things of God maybe. Well, you're only halfway there when you're 60, because Moses was 120 and he was still going strong. And what a wonderful example he was of longevity and stamina and steadfastness in the service of God. And well, I don't know about you, but I always think it's a wonderful thing to meet older believers who are still on fire for God. Older believers who are still full of energy and enthusiasm for the things of God. Maybe physically weakening, but still with a burning passion and with tremendous spiritual ambition in the latter years of their lives. You know, we ran an outreach week in St. Andrews last year, and the idea really was to get a team of young people along to support the different outreaches that we were doing. And predominantly it was a team of young people who joined us, but there was one lady who joined us who was in her mid-70s, and she wanted to get involved and she wanted to be part of the team, so that was fine. We don't discriminate by age or anything like that. And she came along, and what a wonderful help she was. What a wonderful encouragement she was. What a wonderful example she was to us who were younger, still full of energy and enthusiasm. And you know, when the young folks were struggling to get out of their beds in the morning, she was up and ready and raring to go. And when the younger folks were beginning to flag at the end of the day, she was still going strong. And, you know, by the end of the week, we actually had to tell her to take an afternoon off because we were a wee bit worried she was going to overdo it. But it's wonderful just to meet older believers who are still going on strong for God. And Moses was a tremendous example of that. He had never lost his vision, and he had never lost his passion for the things of God. And it seems that Moses' example of commitment rubbed off on Joshua, because he was also marked by tremendous commitment to God. In Numbers 32, the Lord says of him and Caleb, they have wholly followed the Lord. You know, what a wonderful thing that is to have written over your life, that he or she has wholly followed the Lord. You know, that'd be a good thing to have on your gravestone, good thing to have in the obituary column of whatever the local newspaper is. They wholly followed the Lord. That was Joshua, and that was Moses. And so Joshua learnt something of the importance of commitment to the work of God. But then he also learned about the importance of care for the people of God. Care for the people of God. You know, for years, Joshua had witnessed Moses faithfully and lovingly leading a company of people, despite their frequent moanings and groanings. And what a company of people they were. And how often they groaned and they moaned, and they were discontent and they were dissatisfied, and how difficult it must have been for Moses. And yet Joshua witnessed how he dealt with that. And you know, that really would stand him in good stead for what lay ahead. Such was the extent of Moses' concern for the people that when God summoned him to ascend Mount Nebo to die in Numbers 27, Moses responded by asking the Lord, not anything to do with himself, but by asking the Lord to appoint someone who would care for the people, so that the congregation of the Lord be not a sheep which have no shepherd, in his words. And so Moses showed Joshua the need to really care for the people of God. And clearly, in a number of ways, Moses had been a tremendous example to Joshua. And maybe now, as he faced this new challenge, he wondered how he would manage without Moses there by his side. You know, he'd been so used to every day being with Moses, and Moses being there by his side, and now Moses was gone, and maybe he just wondered how he would cope without Moses. And I suppose sometimes we feel a little bit like that, don't we? When great men and women of God who've been a tremendous help and encouragement and influence to us over the years are taken from us, and we sometimes wonder, how will we cope without them? Who are we going to go to for guidance and advice? You know, sometimes I feel a little bit like that, and some of you will know that Peter Brandon, before he was called home to heaven, was a great help to me just in the last couple of years. And sometimes I really wish he was still here. And I really wish I could just go and speak to him about certain things and ask for his advice and his guidance. And maybe we all feel a little bit like that at times. People who have been such a help to us, and now they're not here. And we wonder, how will we cope? But you know, the things that Joshua had learnt from Moses over the years would help him cope without Moses now that he was gone. You know, I love the way that this book begins. It says, now after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord. You see, everything didn't end with Moses. Great though he was, inspirational leader though he was, wonderful servant of the Lord though he was, everything didn't end with him. And Joshua would be the man who would carry things on. And the time that he had spent studying the example of Moses and learning from Moses would undoubtedly stand him in good stead for the challenges ahead. But then as we come to the third point tonight, not only did Joshua have the experience of the past and the example of Moses, he also had the enlightenment of the word. You know, the psalmist says, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. And Joshua had the word of God, albeit a very limited amount of it, to shed light on the road ahead. The book of the law is mentioned in verses 7 and 8, and this would be his guide. You notice in verse 7, the Lord outlines to him the secret of success and the pathway to prosperity. He says, observe to do according to all the law which Moses my servant commanded thee. Turn not from it to the right hand or to the left, that thou mayest prosper. Or as Helen Spurrow puts it in her translation, that thou mayest behave wisely wherever you go. And it seems that the Lord is saying, Joshua, if you want to know how to handle the changing circumstances of life correctly, if you want to know what to do when you face new challenges, you'll need to saturate yourself in the scriptures. You'll need to read them and heed them. You'll need to learn them and live them. And you know, for us today, the secret to acting wisely and handling situations correctly is no different. The Word of God is absolutely essential, isn't it? We've got to saturate ourselves in the Scriptures if we want to know how to act wisely in the changing circumstances of life. You see, Joshua had been well equipped for this new challenge ahead. He had the Word of God. But now in verse number 8, he's given the step-by-step guide as to how to use this piece of equipment effectively. And you know, it's very instructive for us today as well. We've got the Word of God in our hands. We've got everything that we need. But verse number 8 really tells us how to use this piece of equipment effectively. It's the instruction manual, as it were. It says there, "The book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth." He's saying, Joshua, you've got to prioritize it. "But thou shalt meditate therein day and night." Joshua, you've got to ponder it. "That thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein." He's saying now, Joshua, you've got to practice it. "For then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success." He's saying, if you do those things, then you will prove it. And so he's saying, prioritize it, and ponder it, and practice it, and you'll prove it. And I want to just very briefly mention these three things, or four things. First of all, he says, prioritize it. Keep this book of the law always on your lips. And the thought here is that of consistency, always on your lips. Consistency. I wonder how consistent we are with our reading and our study of the Word of God. You know, that's a very basic, simple element of Christian living, isn't it? But it's an essential part of Christian living. I wonder how consistent we are with our reading of the Word of God. You know, we'll only read the Scriptures consistently if we make them a priority. And so the simple question, I suppose, tonight is, where does reading the Word of God come on your priority list? How often do you make time to read the Scriptures? You know, we've got to make time, don't we? We never just find time to read the Scriptures. We never just sort of find the odd few minutes here and there. Life's so busy, and there's so many things pressing for our time. We've actually got to make time. And the things in our lives that are priorities, we make time for, don't we? We set aside other things, and we make time for them. And I suppose the question is, do we make time for the Word of God? You know, that's a sure sign of whether or not it's a priority in our lives, whether or not we actually make time for it. If it's not a priority, we'll just never quite get round to it. You see, the book of the law had to be a priority for Joshua if he wanted to successfully face the challenges of his life. And similarly, the Word of God has to be a priority for us if we want to successfully cope with the changing circumstances of ours. A.W. Tozer once said, "Whatever keeps me from the Bible is my enemy, however harmless it appears to be." Whatever keeps me from the Bible is my enemy, however harmless it appears to be. You know, it's worth asking yourself tonight, as I ask myself as well, what is it that keeps me back from the Word of God? What is it that gets in the way? What is it that prevents me from getting around to reading the Scriptures consistently and regularly? It could be a whole host of things, and it could be different things for different people. You know, it could be our friends. You know, it's a good thing to have friends. Some of us would like to have some more friends. But, you know, sometimes friends can be a hindrance, and friends can hold you back, and friends can get in the way if they're constantly wanting to be doing things, and if they're constantly wanting to be in touch with you and so on. Maybe it's not our friends. Maybe it's our Facebook. Maybe it's our phones. You know, these things take up so much of our time nowadays. And there's nothing wrong with them in themselves. They're useful things if they're used correctly. But, you know, sometimes they take up so much of our time. And sometimes they just hold us back from spending time reading the Word of God. And so we need to make time to read God's Word. I've no doubt that many people here made New Year's resolutions about reading the Word of God. I suppose it's kind of something that we all do, isn't it? We're going to try harder this year to read more consistently and read more consecutively and so on. And usually by this time of the year, it's all kind of frittered away and fizzled out and so on. Well, maybe we can make a new New Year's resolution tonight to recommit to making time to read consistently and consecutively the Word of God. Whatever keeps me from the Bible is my enemy, however harmless it appears to be. Joshua had to prioritize the Word of God. Secondly, he had to ponder the Word of God. You see, not only was he to prioritize the Scriptures, he also had to ponder them. It says there, meditate therein day and night. I wonder if you ever meditate. You know, I understand that the word comes from a Hebrew word that literally means to mutter to oneself, to talk to yourself. So maybe some of you are now thinking, actually, I do. I meditate quite a lot. I talk to myself a fair bit. Well, that's okay. The next time somebody asks you why you're talking to yourself, you can tell them you're meditating, providing you're talking to yourself about the Scriptures, of course. But, you know, I suppose that's the idea, isn't it? Talking to ourselves about the Scriptures. Having your own little Bible reading in your mind. And chewing it over so that you can properly digest it into your heart. And that's where it needs to get to. It needs to get to our hearts. And it only gets there if we meditate upon it and digest it properly. You know, the psalmist says, thy word have I hid, stored, treasured up in my heart, that I might not sin against thee. Not just in my head, but in my heart. And so that means we've actually got to think carefully about it. There's almost an element of memorization there, isn't there? To actually memorize the Scriptures. I suppose that's a bit of a dying art nowadays. And you get older believers and they can reel off Bible verse after Bible verse. And, you know, as younger folks, we're kind of struggling to remember where certain verses are and how to finish certain verses. And I suppose the problem is if we don't know, we just go on to Google or something like that and we pull it up instantly. And that's a bit of a problem because you're not always going to have your phone with you to be able to look things up. You've got to try and memorize an element of the Word of God and chew it over in our minds and digest it into our hearts. I understand that back in the 1960s, transcendental meditation became quite a popular thing. And the concept of that is that you spend 15 to 20 minutes twice a day sitting quietly with your eyes closed, repeating over and over again a mantra, which is basically a word or phrase that has no meaning in itself. And as you repeat this meaningless, pointless phrase, it is meant to empty your mind of everything. Maybe it wouldn't take too long for some of us to do that. But I wouldn't recommend transcendental meditation. You know, the whole idea of it is that you empty your mind. Well, that's a far cry from biblical meditation, isn't it? Biblical meditation is all about filling your mind and filling your mind with the Word of God. And as the Word of God fills our thoughts, it renews our mind. And it revolutionizes our lives, according to Romans 12 and verse 2. And Psalm 1 tells us that meditating on the Scriptures is really part of the recipe for a spiritually happy and healthy life. It says, blessed is the man, happy is the man, whose delight is in the law of the Lord. And in his law doth he meditate day and night. And so there's another resolution for us, not just to read, but to meditate upon the Word of God, to prioritize it and to ponder it. But then he was also to practice it. And this is where it starts to get really difficult, isn't it? Because it says he was to observe to do according to all that is written therein. You see, when we ponder the Scriptures, they begin to permeate our thought process, don't they? So that when our circumstances change, our minds are so saturated in Scripture that we instinctively know the correct way to react and respond, and the theory becomes practice. And that's the way that it should be, isn't it? And that is vital, that the theory becomes practice. Now, James speaks about that in his epistle, be ye doers of the word and not hearers only. And the importance of living out what we take in. And I suppose that always comes as a challenge to me, and maybe to you as well. How much of the theory do we put into practice? What is our conversion rate? As we think of all that we take in, how much do we live out? I think if we were able to calculate that, we'd all be pretty embarrassed. As we think of the wealth of Bible teaching that is available to us here in Scotland. And, you know, we were thinking just earlier of even all the meetings that are on just within maybe 20, 30 miles of here today. And you think of all the meetings that take place over the course of a week. And I know certainly back home in Perth, there's ministry on a Wednesday night, and there's ministry on a Friday night, and there's ministry on a Saturday somewhere in the region, and there's ministry on a Sunday, and there's hours of Bible teaching getting poured in every single week. And over the course of the year, there must be hundreds of hours of Bible teaching that is getting poured into our ears. And I wonder how much of it is really working its way out in our lives. You know, that's a real challenge. And if we could calculate that conversion rate, I don't suppose any of us would be particularly happy to be sharing it with one another tonight, because I imagine for most of us, certainly if you're anything like me, it's probably embarrassingly small. And you notice also the important little word in verse number 8. Do according to all that is written therein. And this is probably why it's so difficult. According to all that is written therein. In other words, Joshua, make sure you're not just submitting to what suits you. Total obedience is required. You know, it's easy to put into practice the things that are easy to put into practice. But there's a whole load of things that we find in the Word of God that really are difficult and really do cut across our lives and our lifestyles. And yet the word to Joshua was, do according to all that is written therein. And he goes on to say, well, if you do these things, if you prioritize it and you ponder it and you practice it, then you'll prove it. You'll prove the reality of it, because he says, for then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success. After you've